Silvia Naef, who is known to most of you. She's full professor at the University of Geneva, and she has written widely on modern art, visual representations, and images in the art world. And today she will talk about Venice and Beyond, exhibiting artists from the art world. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Cristina, for this introduction. And I would, first of all, really want to thank very warmly the organizers of this whole conference. I mean, first of all, for taking the initiative, and then for organizing it, and for really inviting all only interesting speakers, which is really a success, I think, in a conference. I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed as well the contributions of colleagues and young researchers from universities and from other research institutions. And I also very much enjoyed the three artists that spoke here. It's not the first time I hear artists speaking, and I think all of you said really important thing in a very moving and at the same time also very structured way, and I really appreciate this. And thank you again to Cristina and to Roberta for organizing this. And also, I'm not finished with my thanks. I want to thank for giving me the opportunity to give a keynote lecture. So, in my lecture today, I will concentrate on some recent survey exhibitions dedicated to the Arab world as a whole, which you might have seen, some of you. And I will focus not only on the shows, but on the catalog texts. For art historians, as French art historian Béatrice Royeux-Prunel highlighted in a 2015 article, catalogs are a precious tool. In addition to that, catalogs on non-Western art, including art from the Arab world, I don't like this expression, non-Western art, but what to use, what else to use? They aim, that's what they say, at giving a clue to readers and visitors whose knowledge of art production of the region is spare. And they also aim at functioning as key, allowing to understand what the Western viewer often sees as an unfathomable artworks. As curator Pablo Lafuente wrote on Catherine David's contemporary Arab representations, and I quote, "The installation not only communicated to the viewer an imperative to research, read, listen, talk, in order to be able to access what was to come. It also suggested that, even with the help of printed matter, the works might still remain inaccessible, leaving the viewer no choice other than circumventing them." And another author spoke of lost in translation. I mean, there is a lot of this idea that people don't understand what they see, even by art historians and other authorized authors. Now, in 2014, Media Farzine, who was already quoted here, contributed to the catalog of the New York exhibition here and elsewhere, to which I will come back, with an article on shows of Arab art around the world, starting from what we can consider the two precursor exhibition, Primitivism in Modern Art in New York 1984 and Magicien de la Terre in 1989 in Paris. Media Farzine related that after these historical shows, group shows had presented art from the Arab world to Western audiences with a strong increase after 9/11. I'm not sure this is true for Europe because I think the increase started early on, but anyway. This is one of the stereotypes you can find in writing about Arab art shows, that everything started with 9/11. She concluded saying that, and I quote, "The year 2009 is in many ways an organic endpoint for this chapter, as the economic recession and the Arab Springs changed the perspective." She added that after that date, many projects were local affairs or solo projects, or conversely, statements on the biennial and triennial level. My topic today will be to discuss some post 2011 exhibitions, not exhibitions that dealt specifically with the uprisings, but shows that presented art from the Arab world in Western cities. And in spite of the fact that the institutions in the region itself started to make more and more exhibitions, and I think this is a very good sign, I will concentrate on shows in Western cities. Why? Because the topic of this conference is the role of the Venice Biennale, a Western institution, and the Arab world. So I want to go beyond it and speak about exhibitions that say they will show art from the Arab world. However, and I think this also connects with some points that were already evoked during these 2 days, before entering the core of my topic, let me make a preliminary remark, which I think is very important in this context. Inclusive shows that started being created in the West since the year 2000, and in which artists from the Arab world, among others, have been showcased, were mostly labeled as Islamic, African, or Middle Eastern. Of course, much fewer shows were dedicated or labeled Arab world. This might seem obvious, since the Arab world, which I think the definition I prefer to use is as being equal with the member countries of the League of Arab States, in order not to enter discussions about what the Arab world could be. Of course, the Arab world is a smaller entity than the previously mentioned ones. However, in my sense, the reason is not only one of territorial extension. In a lecture he gave with the title Oil and Sugar, Contemporary Art and Islamic Culture in October 2006 at the Royal Ontario Museum in Toronto, and which was published in 2009, Glenn Lurie, director of the Museum of Modern Art in New York, stated, while discussing what label should be used for artists and artworks of Middle Eastern origin, and I will quote it. Since the term Islamic, which he puts in quotation marks, is so charged with potentially negative meanings and, in any event, is not at all clear, the auction houses and some galleries have started to identify much of what is being made as Arab or Iranian, which he puts again in quotation marks. But these terms are equally problematic and exclusionary. Arab, quotation marks, in particular, raises the same kind of issues, at least from an epistemological point of view, as Islamic. As it assumes a pan-national identity for artists and regions that have distinct and different social and cultural structures, histories, and values. Glenn Lurie is by far not the only one having an issue with the definition of the Arab world in the realm of, let's say, art. The Egyptian curator Ehab Laban, who is an artist and curator, he created 2 editions of the Cairo Biennale, asserted in 2012 in a Paris catalog that there is no such a thing as a unified Arab culture, each country having its own history and experiences, recognizing, however, that there are some specific cultural traits that are shared in the Arab-speaking region, allowing one to trace a common picture. I could give other examples, but I limited to those 2. Although such statements reflect without any doubt reality, since Benedict Anderson's seminal book Imagined Communities, we all know that no nation or ethnic community in the world comes out of nature. It is always a cultural construction. Thus, if a political Arab nation does not exist indeed, there is an Arab world with all its differences in history, cultures, and values, as long as people living in the region defined by this term will identify themselves at least partially with it. It is also interesting to note that probably nobody would oppose that there is something like a Latin American community, which in spite of political, linguistic, ethnic, and religious difference, recognizes itself as such. Thus, we must presuppose that there are other than factual reasons that explain that the existence of an Arab world and subsequently of an Arab art scene is rejected by some, and we might deduct that exhibiting artists from the Arab world becomes a kind of proactive initiative, maybe, I say maybe, a significant statement. Thus, the criterion for choosing the exhibitions I will discuss was that they would claim to expose exclusively or almost exclusively artists from the Arab world. Three exhibitions held in main centers of art in the West will be discussed here, and you have it here. 25 ans de créativité arabe, held at the Institut du Monde Arabe in 2013, here and elsewhere at the New Museum in New York, and Imperfect Chronology, Arab Art from the Modern to the Contemporary at the Whitechapel Gallery in London. So you really have the three main cities of art, in some way, in the West. 25 ans de créativité arabe was held in 2012 to 2013 at the Institut du Monde Arabe in Paris in order to celebrate the IMA's 25th anniversary. There was a bilingual French-Arabic catalogue. The Institut du Monde Arabe, and maybe many of you know this, but I just want to stress this, results from the cooperation of the French Ministry of Foreign Affairs, it was a project going back to De Gaulle, and the countries of the Arab League, so it's not dependent on the Ministry of Culture. Thus, it was, at least at its start, less a cultural than a political institution, a kind of French showcase for the Arab world. It owns, as most of you probably know, an important collection of 400 and some works of modern and contemporary art from Arab countries. After having been on permanent display in the first years after the Institute's opening in 1987, that collection was relegated to the storage. Only recently, a few works of modern art have been included in the new presentation of the permanent collection, which consists mostly, what it shows consists of Islamic art, that opened in 2011. 120 pieces from this modern art collection were presented briefly in 2007 and 2008 under the title Modernité plurielle, plural modernity. Now, going back to the 2012-2013 exhibition, following Mona Hazindas, the Director General of the Institut du Monde Arabe at that time, the exhibition was, and I quote, in line with the work accomplished by the Institut since a quarter of a century and aimed at showing the main trends that had developed in recent years. Curated by Ahab al-Laban, it showcased 40 artists from 16 of the 22 member countries of the Arab League, with a strong Saudi, Egyptian, and Moroccan representation. There were, in fact, six Saudi artists. And you see here, this work was already shown during these 2 days, but well, that's the one I picked up. There were six Saudi artists, five for each of Egypt and Morocco, three for Lebanon, Tunisia, and Iraq, two for the UAE, Algeria, Syria, and Kuwait, and one each for Libya, Qatar, Palestine, Bahrain, Oman, and Sudan. The Comoros Islands, Djibouti, Jordan, Mauritania, Somalia, and Yemen were not represented. Curator Al-Laban explained that for the selection of the works, he retained four possible criteria. They're dealing with political issues, their address of social or economic questions, a personal aesthetic approach, or their involvement with the effects of globalization. No medium was privileged. In order to give an overall picture of the state of contemporary creation in the Arab world, which was the purpose of the exhibition, the exhibited works ranged from painting and sculpture to these videos and installation. The catalogue included texts by Iraqi art critic Farouk Youssef and French art historian Véronique Riffel, former director of the Paris municipality-run Institut de Culture de l'Islam. Farouk Youssef observed that in his paper that artistic commitment, formerly a mere aesthetic question, had turned into something else. This was an important thing, because this exhibition was held just after 2011 and was, of course, very much influenced by these events. He continued saying that the American invasion of Iraq and the recent upheavals, but also the new role of photography and of women artists, and the newly acquired freedom had moved Arab artists who had spent most of their energies on the autocratic rule in perfecting the tools of modernity to turn towards the political and social meaning of art. Art, in his sense, was no longer a metaphor aimed at embellishing life. It was rather, as he concluded pessimistically, and I quote, maybe that unique document that proves that we, meaning the Arabs, are still alive. Veronique Riffel's contribution turned on two points: the importance of the 2011 Arab uprisings and the Orientalist view from which Western curators and audiences wrote on art from the Arab world. An Orientalist bias, she wrote, can be still found in the comments on the street art exhibitions held in numerous galleries, which became popular after the overthrow of autocratic regimes. She called for a reappropriation of Arab identity by Arab themselves, and thought that the choice of an Egyptian curator for the present exhibition was a step in the right direction. Both Youssef and Riffel pose relevant critical questions, but they are very generic ones. So I remember all these catalogs pretend to be a kind of key on how to read the works presented. The authors do not mention the exhibited objects, and one may question whether they offer any clue as to how the artist's work can be understood, other than very general ones. There is also another point which we find in most exhibitions, and that you have a lot of diaspora artists and artists from the countries themselves. I don't have any problem with diaspora artists and about their legitimacy, but I have a problem with the way they are presented, because they are still presented as people living in the region and representing the region. And I think when somebody is living in Paris or New York, even if his or her ties with the country of origin is very strong, as we saw yesterday in the two presentations, it's another thing, and this should just be mentioned. And this was not mentioned here, and it's not mentioned in other catalogs. Now, the other exhibition I want to speak about here is Here and Elsewhere, which was held at New York's New Museum in 2014. It was, of course, it was another type of museum, and it was conceived very differently than its Parisian counterpart. It was the first exhibition exclusively of contemporary art from the Arab world in a well-known New York museum. Although, and this is very interesting, and I really looked again on it, the term Arab does not appear in the title. So, of course, you have it in the text, but you don't have it in the title, even as a subtitle or anything, and you don't have it as a subtitle in the catalog. And, by the way, the catalog is not called the catalog, it is named accompanying book, so it has it wants, I think, to give the idea that it's something more than a catalog, a book that helps to think about this event. So in this book, the curators say that it was published with the ambition of enabling the interested reader to situate the exhibited works within the context in which they were created. And of course, another big difference with the Paris exhibition was that we had only works of contemporary art. We didn't have more modernistic works, and we had mostly, not only, but mostly installation. In their introduction, Curators Natalie Bell and Massimiliano Gioni explained that they took inspiration for the title, and this is also interesting, from the 1976 Godard documentary movie Ici et Ailleurs, which had been commissioned by the Service Bureau of the Fatah in order to report the deeds of the revolutionary Palestinian movement. In line with Godard, who, rather than making a political film, decided to, and this is a quote from the curator's text, make films politically, the curator intended to show the, and I quote again, concerns about the politics of representation that have prevailed when Arab artists are showcased in the West. Refusing to frame Arab artists within a preconceived Arab identity, the curators have also rejected the homogenizing view, that's their words also, that presupposes a global audience sharing concerns and tastes, preferring to present the diversity within a specificity. In three roundtables associated with the exhibition published in the book, selected artists discussed the past, the present, and the future of the Arab world. The publication further includes two essays, one showing how political changes and political and artistic changes in Cairo are intimately entangled by Yasmina Rashidi, and the already mentioned review article by Media Farzin on exhibition of Middle Eastern and Arab art. There is also an anthology of recently published critical texts from Bidoum magazine, which was behind the exhibition also. As a whole, the catalogue assembles useful information ranging from discussions with the artists to texts that it would otherwise be difficult to gather. I mean, you can find, of course, all the texts published by Bidoum on the internet, but maybe it's easier to have them in a book. So it's useful, let's say. It's a good initiative, I would say. However, again, and this is a little bit my concern, a deeper art historical perspective is missing, as is a contextualization of the works beyond the artist's own statements. I mean, artist statements are of course important, but you have to give the context of in which these works are created. The palette of selected artists, and this is probably my main criticism, does not greatly vary if we compare with other exhibitions. We always have the happy fuse in some way, being limited mostly to those who have participated in biennales around the world or in blockbuster exhibitions elsewhere, or have been seen in top galleries. And, as I already mentioned, the theme of how different it is to create in the diaspora or in the countries itself is not even mentioned again. So does somebody who visited the exhibition, what does somebody get from it, and what does the person who reads the catalog get from it? Of course, he or she gets a lot of useful information, but there is a more, I would say, art historical and critical perspective which is missing, and it's not the only one. Yes, I wanted also to add that probably the choice of the artist is also due to the fact that it was the first exhibition of Arab artists, of course not of Middle Eastern artists, in an important prescriptive New Yorker institution. So probably there was also the idea to show to New York audiences artists that had been already shown elsewhere. I think this was probably also, this could be one of the logics why those artists had been again presented. Now I will come to the third exhibition which I want to discuss, which is, again, comes from a very different origin. And it was this exhibition in four parts at Whitechapel Gallery in London called Imperfect Chronology, which was an initiative of the Bajir Foundation, which is touring parts of the collection around the world in different places. There had been recently, I think it's still ongoing, there is an exhibition in Paris at the Institut du Monde Arabe this year. There will be one in Yale, and there has been, which is also very interesting, a part of the collection has been shown in Tehran. But why am I interested in this London exhibition? Because it had something that the other ones were missing. And well, I'm also speaking from my art historian point of view. This exhibition had the first two parts dedicated to what we could call modern art in the Arab world, and the other two parts to contemporary art. So there was a kind of concern for presenting, it's also very clear from the text, a concern of presenting today's art production in a context of what art production in the region has, or in the Arab world, because this one really says that it's Arab art, what it has been. So the idea is to give, to put it in a context, what is produced today. And we see it in the catalog introduction, where Sultan Al-Qasimi states that in spite of great differences and varieties in beliefs and tongues, Arab art is a reality. So he has really an opposed position to many other curators. For him, there are issues shared by Arab artists. First of all, he says, and he says this in the introduction, the concern for the Palestinian cause, as it formerly in the 1950s, a concern was the Algerian struggle for liberation from the French, and then the Arab Springs. And he says, Arab art movements, I quote, should not be measured according to a Western art historical timeline, since they are influenced by local and regional political struggles and changes, end of quote. I think at the time when the idea of the very existence of an Arab culture is contested by many, Al-Qasimi does not hesitate to affirm that common values founded in the struggles, and that's an interesting point, for the region's freedom, tie the Arabs together, because this is the common point he seems to really highlight. In the second part of the catalog's introduction, Omar Khulaif presents the exhibition concept and the selected artists. Various other texts highlight particular aspects of art and creation in the Arab region. There are contributions by Kamal Boulata, Iftikhar Dadi, Edward MacDonald II, Nana Shabud, Gilan Tawadous, and Rasha Saltis, giving different perspectives on art from the Arab world and also its, let's say, insertion in a more global context. Now, if we want, of course, you can tell me these are very disparate, different exhibitions. So what is common to these exhibitions? Common to the three of them was the intent of presenting the art production of a whole region over longer periods of time, a concept rarely adopted when presenting modern and contemporary Western art. I mean, we don't have, well, maybe we could have an exhibition on Catalan art, but probably we wouldn't have other, this kind of regional labels. But of course, it is common with other non-Western art production, like Chinese or Latin American art. In 2009, Nat Müller wrote that although these all-encompassing exhibitions end up, and I quote, homogenizing instead of diversifying and create a canon, they are a necessary evil since they give artists from the Middle East the opportunity to exhibit all over the world. Interestingly, and I think this is a point that came out in discussion in these 2 days, and I didn't know when I wrote my presentation, the three exhibitions questioned the very existence of an Arab identity or of an Arab art. This can, of course, be understood in a historical perspective and pinpoints the collapse of the ideology of a political Arab unity, but indicates, in my sense, that there is still a common a sense of common belonging to a cultural area defined by the Arabic language and culture. If this shows share anything, It is that political aspects, in a broad sense, dominate in the end over art historical considerations in most cases. Neither the works nor the artist's paths are the focus, but rather the statements the work are supposed to make, statements that respond to the viewer's expectations when it comes to the Middle East. The political situation of the region and its worldwide impact explain this, but it's also often, not in all the cases, because curators have very different types of origins, very often a limited knowledge of the local art scenes and of their history, of their present state, is another key to understanding this prevalence of politics over artistic consideration. Of course, these are all encompassing group shows, but one could imagine, and this is if we speak about the vision for the future maybe, one could also imagine group shows that would be organized around trends, local and transregional debates or specificities of artists and places or interactions with the cultural genres. Instead of just wanting to show that there is indeed modern and contemporary art in the Arab world, it would be probably more interesting to approach the region through specific questions and highlighting its intellectual debates, which is never made. We always are in politics. However, exhibitions with a historical background, such as imperfect chronology, open, I think, in some way, new path, although there could be also be made some criticism, and constitute a contribution to understand the art context, because I think this is really the thing missing. Thus, they might be first steps in the building of a global art historical consciousness in international audiences. By showing what I like to call the missing modern, meaning this modernist period about which Rosisa also spoke under the perspective of using Arab script, but there are other productions, but it's really a missing time in most of these survey shows. This forgotten period of art history of the Middle East, what we could also call a kind of Arab classical modernity, and its academic predecessors, it reconnects such a show like Imperfect Chronology, the contemporary to its sources. So it brings also the widely shown contemporary art back to its place within the creative production of the region. And this is an important thing because we have all this contemporary art, where else does it come from? And evidences the fact that it does not come out of nothing, or, as often incorrectly stated, that it is not an avatar of Islamic art. More generally, however, presenting a modern artist as opposed to contemporary artists is still considered a risky endeavor. This becomes evident when looking at two recent initiatives, very good initiatives, but taken by the Centre Pompidou and the Institut du Monde Arabe again. As was already mentioned during this conference, in 2016, Sam Bardawil and Tim Ferrat curated Art et Liberté, Rupture, War and Surrealism in Egypt at the Centre Pompidou in Paris. So this was really the very first exhibition about a modern art movement that had originated in the Arab world to be held in one of the most prestigious institutions of the West. And so it was really an event in some way, and it's part of this whole project of working on other modernities or alternative or plural modernities that is part also of the new vision that the Centre Pompidou has of itself. However, the exhibition was sparingly advertised and signposted to the point that it was difficult to find one's way to it through the museum. And in spite of the fact that it took place at the same time with the blockbuster Magritte exhibition, and that for this it could have attracted the attention of some visitors interested in surrealism but not aware of its existence in Egypt, no real attempt had been made to tie both exhibitions in order to attract more visitors. For instance, on the outside of the Centre Pompidou, on the front, you didn't have any banner with the title of the exhibition as you usually have. You had it only on the back of the Institut du Monde Arabe. So you really had to know that the show was going on. And I really have some friend that searched for it in the Centre Pompidou. So I don't think it was a boycott or any kind, but it's strange to see that the very first exhibition of this kind fell relatively short of audiences because of a communication that has not been, I would say, organized as it could have been, at least in its Parisian version, and because it traveled to Madrid, Düsseldorf, to Tate, Liverpool, and Stockholm, I don't know. But I don't think of a conspiration or something, but probably, and it's not the curator's problem, it's not the problem of the people who were in charge of this specific exhibition, but there seems to be no real interest because you could have a common ticket, Magritte and Egyptian surrealism. You didn't have this. So, I mean, usually you would do this when you have a smaller exhibition going with the blockbuster exhibition. So I really think there is a kind of, well, thinking that people would not be interested in this kind of still considered marginal production. The other example is the Institut du Monde Arabe that opened in November 2016, an annex. I think most people don't know that the Institut du Monde Arabe has the Louvre and the Pompidou opened an annex in the north of France, in the city of Tourcoing. And by this occasion, part of the modern art collection was showed there under the title Le Monde Arabe dans le miroir des arts de Goudéa à de la Croix et au-delà, which could be translated, I think, into English, the Arab world in the mirror of the arts from Goudéa to de la Croix and beyond. Most of the exhibition really was consisting of the modern art collection, which is an interesting, I mean, at the time being, I think it's the biggest collection of modern Arab art in a public institution in Europe. I'm not saying I was speaking about the private, but in a public institution. And showing it, taking it out, was a way of saying, okay, we have it. But then we have the impression that the only thing that indicates that there is something else is this word and beyond. Title. Of course, there has been a catalog published and so on, but in the same, we have the impression that it would suggest, and again, it's not the curator's real problem, to suggest that an Orient that might be Arab at some times, but which is defined by antiquity and Orientalism. And this reluctance to admit the focus of the exhibition is on modern art is reflected by the catalog text. There are 7 texts, and only 2 evoke modern art. Other articles are due to Dominique de Font-Réau, director of the Delacroix Museum, and by the way, so they wanted to have a Delacroix, this Femme d'Alger, of course, the founding representation of women in Orientalist art. They didn't get the original because the museum didn't want to give it out, so they got a copy by Fontaine Latour, which is here, and then they got a drawing by Delacroix. So there are only these 2 pieces by Delacroix. And then there are some examples of calligraphy, but interestingly of Mesopotamian calligraphy and so on, which is marked by the term of Goudéa, chosen there. And in the catalog, so we have this article about Delacroix, and we have another article by Yannick Linz, who is the chief curator of Islamic art at the Louvre. This timidity in presenting the modern art collection, the most important public collection in Europe, as I said, could of course be explained by the necessity of attracting audiences in a provincial town in responding maybe to what is supposed to be their expectations of Orientalist colors and archaeological treasures. So what would have been, well, I think what would have been interesting would have been if the curators had dared doing the work that, for instance, Mary Carmen Ramirez did for Latin American art with several exhibitions where she claimed that Latin American avant-gardes were to be considered as equal to European ones and not as backward expression of a unilateral Western modernity. And I think there is really a kind of fear that people could say, well, this backwards things that don't interest anybody, that's why we are not showing them. And there is also a very interesting example coming from the region itself, and not from the Arab world, from Tehran, where the Museum of Contemporary Art has reopened in the spring with its contemporary art collection, where you have many, which was made under Farah Pahlavi, and where you have many, as you see in these pictures, where you have many works by mainly American artists, but you also have a very good collection of modern Iranians. And the very interesting thing in this display that I saw in the spring was that Western artists and Iranian artists were exhibited in the same room. Again, in a way, a little bit like Marie Carmen Ramirez did in the US for Latin American art, it's a way of saying, okay, there is this modernity and Iranian artists are part of this modernity and they are hanging on the walls in the same place, in the same rooms with very well known, as you can see, there is a Rothko there, Western artists. So I think this kind of initiative should be made much more also with artists from the Arab world, and especially in those kind of institutions that have, that can influence audiences, because people would go there and they don't have, I mean, and they would probably seeing more and more exhibitions that would show modern art also from the Arab world would give a sense to other things that are shown around as contemporary art, as we can see at the Biennale and so on. So, all what I said is not to be understood as criticism, as I already said, of the involved curators, who generally are very knowledgeable about the art scene and propose innovative projects. I think the problem lies more, in my opinion, maybe in the institution, the communication and the advertising departments that are reluctant in presenting shows that could be risky since they don't meet the assumed expectations of the audiences, and I think there is the fear of the risk of making exhibitions where nobody would go. But I think this is a wrong fear, this is my opinion, because I think with a good advertising campaign, making things interesting for people, and there are very good marketing people nowadays, and people also in the art field, and you could convince, if you start making exhibitions like this, you could convince audiences that such shows are interesting. However, and as we saw in these 2 days, I think that we are still in a kind of preliminary phase and that things will slowly change, and I would say at least for three reasons. Of course, all the shows I presented are survey shows, and there is always a little difficulty, let's say, with survey shows. But what we see, and they were mentioned also during these 2 days, we have more and more monographic exhibitions, or also maybe less exhibitions on specific trends. And I think this will contribute in setting new standards for survey exhibitions of artists from the Arab world. I mean, there is an important work that is being done at the Tate, and for instance, and in other places. Institutions from the region itself, and I think this is the other point which is important, institutions, museums in the region also will contribute, and Matraf is maybe an example, I don't know, but there is also the Sharjah Museum who has shown again its collection. There are these projects in Tunisia, in Lebanon, and so on. So I think this is a very important point. And the third point, I think, and we really saw it in these 2 days, and I'm working since years on this topic, and I'm really happy to see that new generations of scholars are being trained. And I think this is really important, because we need to write, this is really a little bit my dada, as we say in French, but I mean, this is really my fixed idea. We really have to write a history of art of the Arab world. And we need to go back to the beginnings, to its beginnings, in order to understand what is happening today. Because of course, yes, you can see a work by Walid Arab, and you can read it as a work by Walid Arab. But it's also interesting to know that Walid Arab was not trained in Islamic art, and that there is an art history, modern art history in Lebanon. And I think this puts also, this gives also another value to the work of Walid Arab. And this is always forgotten. And this is why I have a problem in the non-contextualization of such shows, in spite of the fact that I'm happy that these shows do exist. But I think new generations of scholars have to be trained, and they are trained. I think this is really a good thing, because we will have, in a few years, when I started working on this, it was really difficult to find material, also in Arabic. And the other point, which I will say, these art historians have not only to be trained in the West, we need really institutions, academic institutions in the region to make really an effort to train doctoral students and in these fields. Why? Because they are on the spot, they speak the language, they know the right people, they are on the spot, they are not 6 months somewhere in Beirut or Cairo or I don't know where, they live there. And sometimes as Yasmin mentioned this morning, you need really months and maybe sometimes years just to get and find the archives, because there is really still, I mean, it's starting to be made, we saw also in the presentation of, I would say, both Sarah Johnson and, you're looking at me, Nadine, who are working on the sources and are going to look for the catalogs and so on. I think this is a very necessary work. And it's good that there are some people doing it in the West, because I'm also, I think we have to build this idea of plural modernity, of different, diverse modernity. Isa spoke about it also. And we have to include it in an art historical discourse, not only for a question of equality and justice, but also because there is a kind of discontentment, this is what with what I began and with what I will conclude, this kind of discontentment that the average Western visitor might feel today at exhibitions of modern and contemporary art from the Arab world, which is caused by a lack of information that prevents any but immediate and superficial readings, can be alleviated by this art history that is in its writing. And it will give back to the region its broader cultural dimension and potential through the development of historical and documentary richness, and help audiences, Western or other, not to miss what an author called the subtleties completely. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Silvia. I think this was the perfect conclusion of our 2 days conference. And we really managed, but it was really enlightening and stimulating, and we really touched the crucial points about the theme we have been trying to discuss in this couple of days. So thank you very much. I think Silvia is ready to answer some questions. Questions? Yes.
If I may say so, for many years I went to lots of conferences to take elsewhere regarding the Middle East and Africa, how to define it and the Arab world. And I got very irritated that always they questioned why is why Arab world, why not simplify, why even question it? 22 countries who speak the same language are and have in their majority the same religion. And so we're questioning it just because of that little Israel there. And we have for every exhibition to include one Israeli artist in order to balance it as an agenda for Western institutions. Really, we had always that, and very often, I can give you many examples if anyone is interested, many things didn't happen on the Middle East or the region because we didn't have the right Israeli artists. I even suggested Israeli artists were Palestinian. They said, no, 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 you know what we mean, which means not a Palestinian and not a Muslim, etc. So I think we have to cut short. Our word is Arab, it's a language. And it's a very geographically united. The leaders know each other, they marry each other, and so on and so forth. But as for the three exhibitions that you selected, I mean, the 25 years of Arab creativity was a major issue for the Institute of the Arab, for the sponsors, Total, who came and complained, for me, who didn't like it, and so on. In fact, with the, despite the wonderful collection that they amassed in the beginning, they never showed that collection, and it was not about 25 years. It was the last 2-3 years, whatever they could collect in 2-3 months, which is totally unacceptable in any other European institution. So there are double standards when it comes to the Arab world. Any stupid person can talk about us, but when it comes to the rest of the world, we go to the big scholars and people who have been on the field for years and years. So this double standard, we have to denounce the double standard and the mediocrity of the many of such exhibitions. Even when Catherine David wrote the contemporary Arab representation, in fact, she went only to Lebanon and talked about a small group in Lebanon. Why call that instead of something a group in Lebanon, for example, or science group in Lebanon? So I think we shouldn't be afraid of defining things as they are. We have to simplify it, go to the point. I don't talk about the other exhibitions, which I also imperfect chronology, which is the fact that kind of Lassini very generously paid every institution, and they took it because of the money. You give £250,000, you are in Whitechapel, in a little room that doesn't speak, visually uninteresting for the Western public, and so on and so forth, because it doesn't have a wow impact. And this, the non-visuality of the representation of the Arab world, is something we have to contest and bring beautiful things, relevant things that are fantastically beautiful, because the culture is beautiful.
Thank you for your comment. I completely agree with you. And with the Institut du Monde Arabe, I mean, I want really to add this. I mean, they really, when they opened in 1987, they had the collection on display. They took it off. And you know what, Institut du Monde Arabe, Arab World Institute, for those who don't understand French, they were showing shows on La Reine de Saba, the Queen of Saba, of Sheba, Phoenicians, pharaohs, and so on. So there was nothing Arab. It was on the geographical, in the area, but not Arab culture. And that's why I mentioned it quickly, but they took it out, this collection, for the 25th anniversary. But there was no catalog, there was just a small booklet. I insisted with the IMA to get some more information. There was nothing. And there is nothing on the internet also. So, there is really no interest for this collection. And now it is in Tourcoing, but even in Tourcoing, they're saying, okay, we have this wonderful collection of modern Arab art. And instead of advertising it, they say, from Delacroix, de Delacroix, Goudéa, what is this, and beyond. The modern comes only in the word beyond, and what could be beyond could be anything.
And in the Palestinian show, which was an excellent show, not even a brochure.
Yeah.
Not even, let alone a catalog, not even a brochure. Don't tell me there are no sponsors for it.
But the Tourcoing show, the curators wanted to have a modern art show, but then they decided it's too risky to have a modern art show, you know. And so they put the old stuff so nobody would be disturbed by it. So anyway.
The Queen of Sheba, Sabaeans, are a pre-Islamic Arab tribe. So it is our history.
Okay.
Not that I want to defend the Institut du Monde Arabe, but what I want to bring up here is a piece of information about curating. In 2002, we had a large exhibition of Palestinian art, the first one in an independent gallery in New York. And the curator, James Heritus, who had been director of the Corcoran and now director of a museum because he had a struggle with the Museum of Modern Art, he was exiled to Texas. He was married into a very strong family there, and they had an independent museum. Now, very rarely do you find independent museums in the USA. I took them to Syria, to cities in Jordan, to all of the West Bank, and at that time, Gaza was open. And in 2003, they opened an outstanding show called Made in Palestine in Houston. 1,500 people flooded the exhibition. Half of them practically cried. His wife has an art car museum. It was the quality of curating. And it was, to me, as good or better a show than any I've ever seen in the MoMA or the Guggenheim or the Tate or anyone else. Because this man knew how to look. He had an exhibition in his brain as we went traveling from studio to studio. He filled the exhibition in his brain. He hung it, and he hung it boldly. And everything written in the catalog, nobody saw it when they came to the opening. They came, they reacted to the art, and they started talking about their own art and how they felt hollow in their lives. And here are people who had real experiences that they were communicating. It was, you don't need to persuade people. They are persuaded when they see a well-curated show. That's my first point. My second point is perhaps a little dissatisfaction with intellectual constructs that some curators think they need in order to make a show acceptable. The fact is, as a challenge to me and to everyone else who is a historian, if I take 1,000 works of art from the entire globe right now and do not put the names on them and do not tell you what country they're from, I challenge anyone to put Humpty Dumpty back together again. I do not think anyone would know what country they came from. Maybe they'd know what 10% of them, where they came from, who they're made by. Were they made by a woman, a teenager, a senior citizen? I think we live in a very globalized world, and we see everything that happens around us. Sorry I took so long.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I just want to kind of echo what everyone else is saying. It is a challenge for us practitioners at this point in time to determine how we're going to present ourselves as Arab, art to a universe that is very alien, to whom we're very alien. So do we use mediums and ideas that kind of we've imported from them, or do we present ourselves in a chronology that contextualize the exhibitions in a social, economic, and political scene that kind of brings us closer for them to understand? I think this is a challenge that all of us will probably be feeling, facing on and on and on. But I don't think there's a specific answer to that. Do we do this or do we do that? And I think this is the beauty of what we do, that we can always put the same question in a million different.
Well, yeah, I think, I don't know what, thank you for your comment or question, yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Naef. It was a pleasure listening to you. I have three comments, I think. One is, I think we're, to address you know, the content of what you mentioned, I think we're now on the cusp of a very interesting period. I think we are leaving the period of the survey exhibition, and we're entering a new phase. In the last few years, we've had four major exhibitions by Arab or Arab-affiliated artists in the quote-unquote West. There was a major Emily Jassim survey exhibition at Whitechapel. There was a major Mona Khatoum exhibition at the Pompidou. Was a major first Selwa Rabash exhibition at the Tate. there is now the Fachermesse exhibition, Tate and Berlin, and then Sursaw. So, and of course, there was the Surrealist exhibition. These are major exhibitions that show us that we are entering a new phase of visibility. However, be careful what you wish for. The exhibition Selma Rodashkin, of course, was full of, was fraught with problems in the catalogue, and Fachermesse for me is an open sore, which I'm not going to discuss here, just mention that. So it's basically what I'm trying to say is that we have to be careful what we wish for, that sometimes you have your long hope for visibility for your pet artist or your pet movement, but then it comes with its own set of problems, as you said, in terms of framing and advertising and so on, but it can also be the curating, the problem with the lazy, lazy, superficial curating. So, to maybe end on a positive note, I just want to make two practical comments. First, advertising and then suggestion. The advertising, because everybody's talking about research, research, I just want to plug the fellowship. There's a 6-month fellowship program which is open for PhD researchers in the Arab world, which is at Darul in Amman, Jordan, Khaled Shuman Foundation. 6 months, I think, paid fellowship to live there and to research their archives. And of course, it's good to have people from the Arab world to do PhDs, but the problem is that if you come up through the educational system, you don't end up wanting to do a PhD on the history of your country. So you end up having to rely on people coming from Europe, you know, or from the US. So we have to take what we can get. Well, the last thing that I want to say is that for me, the solution is to be, to stay vigilant and to stay aggressive and to keep writing and to keep, and not to take things for granted. So my advice is to everybody here, I mean, I'm not affiliated with an institution, is to have a sort of annual conference on Arab art, Middle Eastern art, fine, on Arab art, here in Europe, in the region. The only professional association that I'm familiar with in higher education is AMCA. AMCA is in the US, it's very far away. They have their one conference here, but it's mostly for people affiliated with American organizations. And then they have a few panels at Mesa, a few panels at College Arts. But for people from the region, people from Europe, we cannot access it, you know, with the visas and the travel plans. So, and the money. So, I don't know if Roberta, Christina, Dr. Silvia, everybody, Bahia is gone. She said Bahia can book us rooms at the AUC very easily. To have an annual conference in the region or in Europe about Arab art for people who are not about selling and art dealing, but you know, this type of conference, I think this is a kind of vigilance platform. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I think this is a very good suggestion. I could tell you something about AMCA, but I don't want to say. But I mean, I think they really, you are right. They don't. They are not interested in doing things in Europe and with Europeans. So that's a real, and it's a pity because it could really be a worldwide organization. Yeah, yeah, exactly, exactly. So, well, why not? I mean, I think we can. We are all here. We can think about it. Maybe.
No, I think, but I also joined to try to get them to pay attention to Europe, so I completely agree that there is this really big separation. So I just wanted to say, like, I think a good solution would be if everyone, if we brought this up more to AMCA and like kind of all started talking together and tried to make this a bigger movement, and I don't know if it would work, but I just wanted to say that I think it's a good initiative to try to make it a bigger movement. Oh yeah, and also there's in France, Arvim,
yeah. Arvim is really, I wanted to say this, Arvim is a group de recherche sur les arts visuels, help me please, Johan, du monde, du Maghreb, Mashrek, or something like that, I never know the title, you can find A-R-V-I-M-M. You can Google it. It's a small, I mean, it's a small group of people. It's not really an association, making of which I'm also part, and making a seminar in Paris at the East Russia CES on those kind of questions we debated here. And well, this is one thing, and but I think your suggestion could take it up. And but I wanted to say again, I'm still insisting that we need institutions in the Arab world that should just have their own system and training young people to get curators, art critics, and art historians also in the region. I mean, I think without that we can't. I mean, I don't think Chinese art historians work in China, I'm sorry, they are not only in the US and in Europe. So this makes a big difference, because you need, I'm not saying we shouldn't do the work, we should do our work for us, for people living in the West, but and we can also train people from the Middle East. That's not what I'm saying, we should not train people from the Middle East. But I think until there is no strong institution, because you see the difference with China is also that there are strong institutions, as well for what the museums are concerned, but also the universities. Chinese universities are now among the best ones in the world, and they give training also to art historians. So this is a really important point. And I think you cannot have a region where there is no research really on a topic which concerns the region itself. So I think this is really something that should be encouraged, and there are a few initiatives in Beirut, hopefully in other places also with the time. So that's really, I really believe this very strongly.
Sorry, I just want to do a short comment on curation and initiatives. I started an initiative in Vienna in 2009, and we just have a small non-profit art space. We rely on fundings, and we just do all the work voluntarily. And it's all about a dialogue between the Middle East and Central Europe, or let's say Austria. I started in 2009 when there was just no one talked about it, at least in Austria. While in 2015 all the refugees came, so it grew, like kind of the idea grew and the fear grew. So I'm confronted all the time with very basic fears, let's say. So like people coming to see me like, oh, you're the one working with the terrorists, can we really enter your exhibitions? I mean, we have, this is not, I don't invent this is just the reality. So we did it on all these topics. So I mainly focus on the Iranian sector, but at the moment we have a wonderful artist from the Kurdish area who's working on the Kurdish genocide, Osman Ahmed, I don't know. He did a PhD on the Kurdish genocide in London. So I mean, we try hard to do it. And yes, we have a problem with marketing, but there is people coming, there is a lot of interest. Yes, we do get a lot of trash, literally being bombed at us. But I mean, we just fight for it. And we also, but it's what I say, the space is kind of, we offer this as a platform for communication and for dialogue, because I think that's the most important thing, and we don't only do it in one direction. So it's not only me going to all these countries and bringing the artists back, but also taking the artists from Austria, not only Austrians, just artists living there, to the countries, just to foster dialogue. And I think that's the most important thing, to overcome all these threats and fears.
Thank you. What's the name of the platform?
Hinterland.
Okay.
There's a difference between China and the Arab world, and it's money and independence. And also, someone said experience. Yes, way long before Europe ever started paying attention to aesthetics, China had aesthetics in the third century, mind you. But I want to reiterate that really, and before I forget, I want to thank you for your presentation. Well researched, and I enjoyed listening to you. But I want to stress Darat al-Funun in Jordan, because it's very hard to find a safe place where we can all meet. And even in Jordan, the owner of Darat al-Funun is very, very nervous. And so are many people in Jordan, but that is one potential safe place where we can all meet and wherever. almost everyone can get out, though the Arabs who live under the Israeli state would find difficulty.
Yeah, thank you for reminding this.